We have been climbing through the book of Acts, and we're at chapter 6 today. And I've often thought the book of Acts in the New Testament reads a little bit like grandma's brag book. If you don't know what a brag book is, they used to be these little small photo albums that a grandma would carry in her purse. Now they're iBooks, apparently. But the first few pictures in a brag book are always glowing and perfect of a newborn baby. But then, if you keep adding pictures, as the baby grows up, you lose the glow and you start getting rash, tantrums, maybe colic. And that's kind of how the book of Acts is. The book of Acts, the first chapters 1 through 4 are just glowing. People meeting together daily, sharing all their resources, praying for each other, supporting one another. It's just this glowing picture. But by Acts chapter 6, we're starting to see a problem. Reality hits in many ways. And I think there's some great lessons here today from Acts 6 about how in our lives we have these moments of glowing, which leads to growing, which usually leads to grouching. So if you brought a Bible, we're going to turn to Acts chapter 6. We also have it projected. Starting at verse 1, we read, "In those days, when the number of disciples was increasing, the Hellenistic Jews," those are the Greek Jews, "among them complained against the Hebraic Jews because their widows were being overlooked in the daily distribution of food. So the 12 gathered all the disciples together and said, 'It would not be right for us to neglect the ministry of the Word of God in order to wait on tables. Brothers and sisters, choose 7 men from among you who are known to be full of the Spirit and wisdom. We will turn this responsibility over to them and will give our attention to prayer and the ministry of the Word.' This proposal pleased the whole group, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and the Holy Spirit, also Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicholas from Antioch, a convert to Judaism. They presented these men to the apostles, who prayed and laid their hands on them. So the word of God spread. The number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly, and a large number of priests became obedient to the faith." Will you pray with me? Lord, we are so thankful every time we can read from your word. Thank you for this reading. Speak to our hearts now. Lord, please help me with this message. Help us to hear, Lord, at least one thing that speaks to our hearts of our life with you. In Jesus' name, amen. It is so good to be back with you. I missed my church study leave. I had some study leave time where I read some good books. I'm trying to write a book. I did some sermon and worship planning for this coming year. It was productive. And one of the best things about my study leave time away was that I produced a new grandson. Yeah. Oh, you're welcome. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And, you know, some grandmas have a brag book. I have a brag wall. Let me introduce to you, and he's here with us today. Let me introduce to you Mr. Ross Eli Hoy, our third grandchild, first grandson, and he was born to my daughter Kaylee and son-in-law Sammy, and we are all still on cloud 92. Everybody's healthy and gaining weight. Everybody. And we're doing good. So, but it's so good to be back with you. I want us to think today a little bit about stress, though, and how our lives grow up. And what I said earlier, we have moments of glowing, moments of growing, but then we have moments of grouching, grumbling. Sometimes the giant hamster wheel of misfortune only runs in your tank. And what happens if your life have these moments where it's not just a hamster wheel, it's a conveyor belt of life challenges that seem just too hard. It's a moment like this. I don't know if you've seen this scene.
Candy gets past you and into the packing room unwrapped. You're fired.
Yes, ma'am.
Let her roll!
Classic scene. Now, why is that so funny? Because we've been there. We've had moments in our lives where the production expectation exceeded our ability, and we start popping the quota into our mouth or into our shirts. But here's the problem. Our lives are real. It's not a sitcom. This church is not a sitcom. What we do here as a church counts for eternity. And so we've just read in Acts chapter 6 of the first complaint that we know of ever lodged against the Christian church. And the problem was, apparently, as Pete has said, some of the widows in that church were being overlooked when it came to food distribution. And here's the thing. Only the Greek-speaking widows were going hungry. The Aramaic or Jewish widows were doing just fine. Ouch. And so this problem that arises is both a good and a bad problem. It was a bad problem because it's not just about food. It was about discrimination in the early church. Now, it's a good problem in that it was resolved apparently quickly and in a good way that got the church back to growing. And it's a good problem because it teaches us some great lessons. One of the lessons is the challenge of growth in a church. Growth is good, but usually it causes growing pains. I once read years ago of a large church in Dallas that grew exponentially. But then the church started to fight itself. There were two groups that arose in the church. It went into church court and then civil court. This church divided legally and totally. And I read that all of these problems could be traced to the root. And the root problem was how ham was sliced at church dinners. Right. What does that teach us? It teaches us that in church, food really matters. Right? Food matters. Oh, we all think we're people of peace and we follow the Prince of Peace. But you know, when it comes to our food, don't mess. Right? There's a well-known saying, whenever two or three Presbyterians are gathered together, a chicken dies. We love to eat. Right? And so here's a key lesson. As with churches, as with problems, small can grow and become ugly. There's also in this scene a challenge of conflict. As I said, a certain kind of people, Greek-speaking widows, were being overlooked. Now, at this point, quite happily, this baby Christian church had grown over onto the other side of the tracks of town. And that's good. But now there were these Greekish Christians who were very different from these Jewish Christians. And you can imagine the scuttlebutt. Well, those Greek Christians, they don't talk like we, they don't even use our language. They use a different kind of Bible. Those Greek Christians, they practice following Jesus differently. They even have big Greek weddings. That's just wrong. See, I don't think this problem in Acts 6 was just about food. I think it had to do with differences of language, differences of background and culture, and it was threatening the essential unity with variety that should always be at the core of Jesus' church. And friends, I just want to say, this is one of the treasures of the Christian church you should always enjoy. We get together as different people from different places, different backgrounds. We live in different locations. We have different opinions about politics and economics. But together in Christ, we become one in Christ. That is a treasure. You know, for example, years ago, you welcomed and accepted me into your midst. And if you know me, you know I'm so different from you. Me and my people, we are from a faraway land called Ohio. And in Ohio, they live differently. We are the people who invented meatloaf. Yeah, yeah. And my Ohio culture, we're the ones who brought to the world Jell-O mold salads with fruit embedded in the Jell-O. That's from us. And we are the people who love white bread and Miracle Whip. Mm. Yes, and yet you welcome me into your lives. That's good. So there's this challenge of growth and challenges of conflict. So let's look at the strategies and options that these leaders thought about in figuring this out. You know, one option they could have addressed is they could have just chose to ignore the problem. But you know, if you've ever ignored your hunger, you know how that works out. Secondly, they could have shifted or changed the focus of this new Christian church. They could have decided, well, you know, we're not a church that serves Greek people. Yeah, we only use one language in this church. So sorry. You might want to go down the street. There's a second church of Greeky Christians, and you'll probably love it there. Go there. Thirdly, an option could have been, let's just ask the original 12 apostles to work harder. Yeah. Could you imagine that performance review that year to the 12 apostles? We learned on the personnel committee that if you take 3 less vacation days a year, you can probably do this food thing. Now, what do the apostles do? They do something that's very distinctive and healthy. In essence, they say, the 12 gathers the disciples together and said, it would not be right for us to neglect the ministry of the Word of God in order to wait on tables. Brothers, sisters, choose 7 men from among you who are known to be full of the Spirit and wisdom. We're going to turn this job over to them. Now, there's a bit more to this story, but in essence, this is a response that restores health and forward motion for the church. And I think there's much we can learn from it. One lesson we can learn from this as church today is we must be willing to flex. As a church, we have to be flexible because rigidity leads to rigor mortis. It's a well-known saying, the only person who really likes change is a wet baby. Right, Ross? And can we just stop and appreciate what a big step this was for this church to accept a new idea, of a new band of leaders, the terrific 12 apostles instituting this group that I call the Serving Seven, who will do food ministry. It was the apostles saying to this church, you pick a new group of leaders among us. And by the way, I don't know if you noticed in your Bibles, all seven of these new leaders have Greek names, not Jewish names. What a marvelous and flexible way to ensure the Greek widows would be taken care of. I don't often like to quote Charles Darwin in my sermons, but as a scientist, he once said, it is not the strongest of the species that survive, nor the most intelligent, but those that are the most adaptable to change. Friends, our task in the Christian church today is to live by the timeless truths of God's holy word, but to live those truths in a flexible and adaptive way in this society to be effective for the mission of Christ. Right. If you want to experience the movement of the Holy Spirit in you and in us as a church, we have to be both faithful and flexible to God's leading. A second lesson we learn from this scene is we must be willing to lead and be led. The church, like any organization, needs good leadership. And in the church, our leadership starts with Jesus, who is our head. And Jesus leads through the church by pouring his Holy Spirit into those who serve in sub-leadership. Pastors, elders, deacons, worship leaders, Bible blast teachers, greeters, ushers, on down the line. And today's scripture highlights, if you're not aware, this new band of leaders in the church, which has continued through the years, now known as deacons. I've often said it's a bit clumsy, but I'm sticking to it. Elders in their role represent the brains of the operation. Deacons represent in their leadership the heart of the operation. And so I want us to look at some key leadership values that these leaders effaced in their decision. Leadership values that I believe truly promote health. One, they made a commitment to unity. The idea of serving only one kind of people in the church right from the get-go was perceived as not right. In the early church, as is today, there should be no red state, blue state tension of who is who and who has what. All should be able to rightfully receive food, help, and the love of the gospel. And so an immediate commitment of the early church was to unity, serving and working for all. And I love this phrase in our scripture today, this proposal pleased the whole group. Secondly, there was a commitment to holistic ministry. You know, it's a common mistake in church leadership to focus on only one aspect of church life, but neglect the others. And here we see a clear commitment for both the spiritual needs of the church, prayer and preaching, but also the material needs of serving food and providing practical resources. Friends, welcome to the Church of Christ. It's always both and. It's showing Jesus in word and deed, worship and work, spiritual and physical food. A second commitment these leaders made, or a third, excuse me, is a commitment to God's word and growth. I like how the apostles maintained a clear view of their prime calling, and that was praying and preaching. And I share with my staff here at Northminster, from time to time, you've got to prune the tasks from your tree of life because they add and grow and accrue. And it's key for each of us to maintain what is my main calling, my main duty. Another commitment was a commitment to spiritual character. Notice how the apostles asked the church to select seven who are from among you. Leaders aren't from newbies or strangers. No, who do we know And then they said, men who are known to be full of the Spirit and wisdom. You know, character counts in leadership. In the Old Testament, when Moses was crushed with a heavy workload, it was his father-in-law, Jethro, who said, you need to choose capable leaders, as Jethro said, who fear God, who are trustworthy men, who hate dishonest gain. Good leadership arises from good character, and that starts with the Holy Spirit. A next value, leadership value, that we see here is a commitment to shared ministry. Notice how the apostles bring this concern to all the people, and they say, we will turn this responsibility over to them. Years ago, in a church leadership book, a consultant made a claim that in a healthy church, he said, at least 60% of that church should be involved in some kind of service or ministry in the church or in the community. And I remember closing the book and adamantly disagreeing. I'm sorry. I think it should be 100%. If you're following Jesus in faith, there's no passes here. Every one of us should be able to name one thing we are doing in this community, city, here in this church to make an impact for God, right? This is how we turn the other church over to the work of God's kingdom. It's all of us. There was once a sign in a high school football locker room. I love this sign. It said, don't just play, make an impact. So friends, how are you making an impact of God's love with what God has given you? How are you doing that? I think a third lesson we see in this story is we must be willing to serve. It gets to the heart of who we are as Christians. I think every Christian should have a t-shirt in your drawer, and that t-shirt says, at your service. And it's what we're going to be practicing next Sunday here on Sunday morning, Service Worship Sunday. It's because, friends, Jesus came into the world not to be served, but to serve. And you might recall that scene, John 13, when Jesus is washing his disciples' feet. He takes the form of a servant, a servant's towel. He washes their dirty feet. And then he says, I'm your teacher. Watch me. You do this. And then Jesus added, if you do this kind of a life, you will be blessed. It's only when we're willing to take last place out of love for others that you're really in first place. It's only when you're willing to kneel to help someone because you care, friends, that's when you're standing tallest. And it's only when others see you serving out of love that they will see God at work in this world. You know, this communion table today is a holy table of serving. And as we come here, by the way, this table and its elements were prepared around 6:30 this morning by deacons. The word deacon means server. As we come to this table, we need to remember the one who died to serve us. And I believe some of the greatest problems facing the church today can be solved as we come to this table together and address our challenges with a serving spirit, each of us. You know, if someone is being neglected in this church, well then, you and I, let's wait on their tables. If people aren't learning enough about the Bible and the faith, well, then maybe volunteer to teach on a Bible Blast team. You will never learn more a lesson than trying to be a teacher. If the church needs more relational small groups for discipleship, well, maybe consider taking a risk and starting one, hosting one. Pastor Pete would love to help you. If we need to grow this church, then invite someone you know to meet you here or pick them up for Sunday worship. Next Sunday, we're going to be doing all kinds of things. Start learning about Jesus. And you know, it's when you serve that you find yourself being served in the name of our Savior and Server. I want to close this message today with this little message by Anne Weems, one of my favorite poets. She describes what the Church of Jesus is all about. She writes that the Church of Jesus Christ is where daisies bloom out of a barren land. It's where children lead and wise men follow. It's where mountains are moved and walls come tumbling down. The Church of Jesus Christ is where loaves of bread are stacked in the sanctuary to feed the hungry. It's where coats are taken off and put on the backs of the naked. It's where shackles are discarded and kings and shepherds sit down to life together. The Church of Jesus Christ is where sheep are fed. It's where lost lambs are found. It's where people can disagree and hold hands at the same time. Will you pray with me? God, help me and help each of us here to grow wiser and stronger in living as your church, Jesus. If someone's being overlooked, and Lord, for those moments where I or others might have a prideful spirit, show us how to kneel in service. Lord, show us how to be able to flex and do new things. Show us, Lord, the value of living in holy and righteous character each day. Show us, Lord, how to lead and to be led and to follow you. Show us, Lord, how we can be a beacon of healing, hope, and love to this city. Jesus, we thank you for being the head of this church. Guide us, protect us, lead us in your word and way, that we might be a blessing in your name always. Amen.